করো
I've been a student activist for the last 7 years, and my initial time when I was getting into activism, I've grown up in a Muslim locality in Delhi, which is Jamia Nagar. One of the things, when I was in my graduation, I was not very much into politics. One of the things with which I started doing politics in the campus, and which one of the incidents which forced me to think about a lot of things in terms of what's unfolding in the country, was when in 2008, in September 19, 2008, two Muslim men in my locality were killed in a fake encounter. This was the very famous, or the rather infamous, Butler House encounter. One of them was 17 years old and the other one was 21 years old. I was 22 at that time. As someone who was just a graduation student, who was not much interested in politics, who was just going to class, coming back, going out with friends, not being interested in a lot of things that were unfolding in the world, this incident shook me in terms of, and I thought that this could have been me. They were just looking for anyone and any Muslim name, and by sheer fact of having a Muslim name, one is a suspect. So this, I started thinking a lot of things, I started reading a lot of things. Questions of land grab, questions of forced displacement, questions of special economic zones. So the initial push from that encounter was how the oppression Muslims are facing. But over the next 1 year, as I started reading more, I realized that this is not something specific to the oppression that the Muslims are facing. This is a structural problem. What happened in Butler House, this is happening in Chhattisgarh almost every day. We tried to do a campaign against Operation Greenland. So it's nothing specific that I'm doing now. We've been doing this for a number of years. We faced crackdown, we faced the GNU administration banning an anti-Greenland platform of which we were part. And even today, if you look at the present context, you have a number of issues and a number of kind of oppressions that are happening in the country. All of these are connected. Some get the limelight, some don't get the limelight. The JNU students facing attack gets all the limelight. But at the same time, the limelight is not something we wanted, but the fact that we've got it and we've got a space, it's very important for us now to make these connections. So as someone who's been concerned about what's been unfolding in not just Bastar, but the whole of Central India, the whole of Eastern India.
A fake encounter make you a democratic right activist? Is it in a short?
A fake encounter, let me put it this way, a fake encounter, as it happens, many such incidents, hum logo ko thoda apne comfort zone se nikalte hain. And it's very important, and that was a time when it made me think. It made me think, and the moment one starts thinking and one starts reading, one realizes that a lot of things are invisibilized. But well, it's mind-boggling what's happening. Yeah. And one, after one comes out of that comfort zone, one, there is no going back.
Your research has focused, as far as I know, on land rights and Adivasis. Mm. Could you tell us more about your research, your findings on that?
Once again, as I said, when I joined my MA in JNU, that was the time when Operation Greenland started, and we were doing a lot of campaign. And the good thing about political activism is that it also pushes your intellectual frontiers beyond just your coursework and everything. So for our campaign, for our political activism, we were reading a lot of things in terms of what's happening in Chhattisgarh, what's happening in Jharkhand. And that was also the time when a course was offered in MA on tribal history. So I took that course. And then I did a research paper also during my course graduation. So these two domains have been linked. My political activism and my research, both have been informed by each other, and both continue to be informed by each other. So that was a time when one of the questions that came to my mind, and this is a topic that I picked up for my future research in MPhil and PhD, is that even in a lot of popular literature that comes out on this question, there is one kind of conceptualization that we do, that Adivasis are homogeneous communities who living in complete harmony with nature, and state and capital is coming and completely destroying their livelihoods, and Adivasis as a whole are resisting this thing. Then one of the questions that came to my mind is that how does one understand a phenomenon like Chalwa Judum, an organization of the Adivasis fighting the Adivasis, and what are the how does one understand this phenomenon? And during that time, one of the things, and which has subsequently been a central aspect of my future research, is that one needs to come out of this kind of conceptualization. And this conceptualization is not just something that you will find in popular literature. As I subsequently found out, even in scholarship, for a long time, although although I mean recent scholarship is highlighting the limitations, for a long time this kind of conceptualization continued in scholarship as well. What one misses out, I mean, historically, if you trace the development of these different Adivasi communities, they have also been differentiated, and the differentiation also has to do with how the agrarian systems have changed over the last two centuries, over the last three centuries, and how the colonial encounter, I mean, reconfigured those agrarian changes and sort of gave it a legal validity through land rights and through the title deeds that came into, through the colonial bureaucracy that came into existence. So what one sees is that, I mean, in a lot of these places, state and capital aligns with the local elite within these communities to push through certain of its policies. So it's not through external agents that these kind of policies are operationalized, but rather through internal agents. And when one looks at this question, I mean, to understand resource appropriation in the present context, I mean, one can understand it better. For example, presently a lot of organizations that are working in Jharkhand, in Chhattisgarh, in Orissa, especially after what happened in Niyamgiri also, the bauxite mining, Vedanta's plans of bauxite mining being foiled. Gram Sabhas are the answer.
Yeah.
So you devolve powers to local bodies, and once you devolve powers to local bodies, I mean, one can have more participatory democracy and more inclusive decision making. I challenge this kind of conceptualization, because one of the things that I am saying is that Gram Sabha and the centralized state structures, at times they can also work together to push through the same agenda. In Jharkhand, over the course of my research, I found out that in many places, Gram Sabhas have passed resolutions in favor of mining. Now, how does one understand this phenomenon? Because what one, when one puts this argument that Gram Sabhas have to decide, what one comes away thinks is that the Gram Sabhas actually encapsulate the will of the local communities, but the local communities may not be homogeneous communities, they can be differentiated communities, and it can be the local elite who are being represented in the village panchayats and the Gram Sabhas. So how does one fight against corporate land grab? One also has to fight for democratization within these communities, and that's, the struggle is going to democratize these communities as well. So somewhere people's councils, alternative kind of a people's councils, where you also question the internal elites within the Adivasi communities, who may be acting as brokers for the state, who may be working in very close collaboration with the state. So these are complex questions. Many a times when we pose this question within a community and a state fighting against each other, one misses out the internal complexities of it. And it's very important, and which is where research becomes very important, which is where scholarship becomes very important. I mean, these are not, when I'm doing my research also, the questions I'm posing, these are not abstract questions. I mean, these are not just abstract theoretical questions. These have implications as to how do we strategize and how do we look at the strategies of fighting the present onslaught on the Adivasi population. So, if we understand this complexity, our strategies for resistance will also be much more nuanced.
How effective do you believe you and the student movements has been in amplifying the voices of the marginalized, and what do you hope to achieve through this?
See, over the last 2 years, as different universities have been under attack, from FTII to HCU, yes, to JNU, and now Jadavpur University, they're planning similar attacks. And there are many other universities in Allahabad, Banaras. One of the good things that they've done is that by attacking us, they have stirred the student community into action. One of the very positive developments of these fightbacks, and I'll focus on a university which I'm a part of, JNU. Actually, I want to thank the present government for attacking us, in terms of they've given us an opportunity to bring out a number of issues which we in JNU within an 8,000 student body were constantly raising. Now, by attacking us and by giving us a platform, they've allowed us to actually reach out to a larger audience. And we've, during the course of this movement, if you look at even the Stand With JNU movement, Stand With JNU movement has not just been a movement to save one university space. Sony Sori has come and addressed and spoken about what's been unfolding in Bastar. Jagdalpur Legal Aid Group representatives have come and spoken about what's been happening in Bastar. Workers from different factories across the industrial belt of Delhi in the NCR region, they have come and spoken. Journalists from Bastar have come and spoken. A lot of queer rights activists have come and spoken. So a number of these issues which we had always spoken about and which we have always raised in our small circles, they have got a wider audience. And actually within the student community also, there was this one section that was always dormant. I mean, that was not into politics. They have come back, and they have actually, this movement has politicized an entire generation of students. These are people who will raise difficult questions, irrespective of who's in power. And universities have been chosen out as this place where the government is very vehemently pushing its agenda.